now in session. Please be seated.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Ninth Circuit. Judge Desai and I are very pleased to welcome our colleague Judge Marquez, who is joining us today from the District of Arizona. We have two cases that have been submitted today. Those are United States versus Lopez Garcia and United States versus Harvey II. Our first case for argument this morning is United States versus Murad, and counsel, you can approach when you are ready.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court, Devin Burstein on behalf of Ms. Murad. Your Honors, as this court has repeatedly held, quote, if the evidence that someone else committed the crime is in truth calculated to cause the jury to doubt, the court should not attempt to decide for the jury that this doubt is purely speculative and fantastic, but should afford the accused every opportunity to create that doubt. Here, Your Honors, in excluding the mechanic's written confession, the district court denied Ms. Murad that opportunity. This was error under Rule 804b3 that undermined her constitutional right to present a complete defense based on third-party culpability. Equally problematic was the district court's error in allowing the government to play the material witness's deposition testimony with no showing at trial of unavailability. As this court held in Matis-Zayas, quote, the district court committed plain error by admitting the deposition testimony into evidence without any showing by the government at trial that the material witness was unavailable. Here, because the government did not and could not establish unavailability at trial, admission of the deposition testimony violated Ms. Murad's rights under the Sixth Amendment's Confrontation Clause. Your Honors, for either or both of these reasons, this court should vacate Ms. Murad's convictions. I'm happy to address the two issues we've raised in either order, but if the court doesn't have a preference, I'll jump into the written confession.
You can proceed in the order that you wish. Would you like to reserve any time for rebuttal?
I'll do my best to watch the clock and keep 2 minutes.
Okay, great.
Thank you very much, Your Honor. So beginning with the mechanic's confession, it was admissible and should have been admitted as a statement against interest, as Judge Sammartino indicated in her tentative in limine rulings. There are three requirements under Rule 804b3. The declarant must be unavailable, the statement must tend to subject the declarant to criminal liability, and there must be corroborating circumstances indicating the statement's trustworthiness. As we've discussed in our briefs, the statement here fulfills all three requirements. As a practical purpose, beginning with unavailability, for all intents and purposes, as a practical matter, we know Mr. Botella would be unavailable at trial. But we don't even need to reach that because the district court assumed unavailability, as the government conceded in its briefing, and based his decision, this is Judge Robinson now, on the other two prongs under 804b3. But to address unavailability, it's important to indicate first that we know in practice what would have happened. Had he shown up, the judge would have appointed counsel for him, as the government asked for the other witnesses, and what always happens. And no counsel in his or her right mind would let Mr. Botello take the stand and confess to a crime, a federal felony conspiracy to smuggle undocumented people. That just wouldn't happen. So as in the Fifth Circuit's Thomas case, to quote, the existence of the Fifth Amendment privilege and Mr. Botello's right to assert it are patent. Another problem with the government's unavailability argument is really that's a trial issue, which is exactly what Judge Sammartino noted in her in limine rulings. What Judge Robinson should have done is said, well, let's see if he shows up at trial. If that was the concern, But it wasn't, because everybody assumed unavailability. And that's why Judge Robinson...
Let me ask you a question about the corroborating circumstances issue, because I think that's the tougher issue for you here. So the district court, it seems to me, considered relevant factors. It noted that there was no evidence showing that the officer was actually an officer, that the witness's name was written inconsistently. The government argued that Botello's testimony about fixing the tire contradicted its expert witness's findings that the tire was never fixed. So what are the corroborating circumstances that indicate the trustworthiness of that?
Okay, so this court typically considers four factors. The confession, the first, and that's under Slaughter and a variety of cases. But before I get to the four, and I'll walk the court through the four factors for reliability, but before I get there, there's an overarching point that's kind of missed, which is this guy has no motive to fabricate. It's not like he's sitting in jail and he's trying to curry favor with a prosecutor.
But counsel, I don't think that that's the issue because, yes, he must not, maybe he has no motive, but the district court has to weigh the evidence and make sure, or be the gatekeeper and make sure that you're going to present something that's authentic and has been authenticated, that's trustworthy, that has been corroborated. So Thus the four factors, and I think that's where I'm having an issue with this, is this wasn't signed before a notary. It could have gone before a notary in Mexico where they could have signed it. It could have been, so many other things could have been done to make sure that this was a trustworthy document.
Right, and I take Your Honor's points, but I think that it's almost a little bit of a cart before the horse problem, because what I think Your Honor is hitting on is exactly what should have happened at trial. Your Honor used the word authenticate. This is not about whether it necessarily would have come in at trial. This is whether it was admissible under the hearsay rule. An investigator, as the defense lawyer at the time indicated, would have to testify to authenticate the document. And then the government could have raised all of those points that Your Honor just did. It wasn't this, it wasn't that, or what happened. The investigator would have had to authenticate the document for it to come in. But that's a separate question. And that's the whole point. It's like, why do we have jury trials? We expect, our system credits 12 regular people with the ability to sort through it all. The point is not, as Your Honor indicated, to gatekeep, yes, but not to stop the jury from doing its job. The government could make all of these points, but it would have had to come through the investigator who signed the document. Judge Thomas, you raised the idea about the name being switched. His ID is on it with the right name. I mean, I think that's a total red herring of an argument. It was signed in front of multiple witnesses, including the investigator who would have had to testify to authenticate it. So that, in and of itself, makes it incredibly reliable, because that guy is the one who's going to have to sit there and answer questions. Did he say this in front of you? Yes. What did he say? This. When did he say it? There. Where were you when this statement was taken? All that has to happen at trial
Why didn't it happen before the district court judge?
Great question. And that's exactly the problem, because the procedure, well, I'll answer the question. The procedural history here. Judge, when that lawyer walked into court after the trial was moved to Judge Robinson, he was walking in with a grant from Judge Sammartino. He walked in blind to Judge Robinson switching his in limine ruling. No lawyer would be prepared to say, all he said was, you know, the investigator is prepared to testify. There was no indication that Judge Robinson, there was no written order, there was nothing, counsel be prepared to address this issue. He was thinking it's coming in, and then Judge Robinson switches it at the last moment. There's no reason for him to have prepared all of this other stuff. He was relying on Judge Sammartino's tentative rulings. So that it's almost, I don't want to use the word sandbagging because that has a negative connotation, but you can understand being in the defense lawyer's shoes, walking into court, and all of a sudden Judge Robinson switches things. You're not going to be prepared to say, make all of these arguments. But, you know, with some space and some time, we're making the arguments now. And again, all of that should have happened before the jury. I'm not saying the government couldn't have made proper authentication objections or anything, but that's not what's before the court. What's before the court is 804B3. And we satisfy all of those requirements. I see I have 30 seconds. I think it is important to use them, though, to continue on your Honor's question, Judge Thomas, about so there are multiple witnesses. Corroborating evidence comes in multiple forms. It comes with a color copy of the ID. There's no reason the government had this early in the case. They could have investigated this. And the most important thing is this letter matches up very closely with the facts of the case. Sure, anybody can nitpick some things, but if we look at what the letter said and what the testimony was, there is no way this letter could have been written by somebody who didn't know the facts of this case. It is flatly impossible, and that in and of itself is the greatest corroboration.
Okay, we'll give you a minute on rebuttal.
Thank you so much.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court, Amy Wong for the United States. This Court should affirm the District Court's decision to exclude a hearsay letter purportedly written by a mechanic in Mexico. That was not an abuse of discretion. And it should also affirm the conviction because the District Court did not plainly err when it allowed in the material witness deposition after the government had established that the material witness was unavailable for trial and Murad had multiple opportunities to object to the admission and did not.
Okay, so tell me where the record demonstrates the government's reasonable efforts to procure Rosales Flores for the actual trial date, which was March 22nd.
So in the government's in limine filings, the government explained that at the deposition, we gave Murad a subpoena package. The subpoena.
But this is the motion in limine hearing was held over a month before the trial date, correct? When they referred to the video deposition of the material witness.
Yes, Your Honor.
So why would they not do it closer to trial with the new trial date? What happened there?
So, I'll get to that. Just give me a little bit of background. They gave the subpoena package at the deposition back in November. Then, before the first trial date was set, the government gave an updated package to the Matt Witt's counsel, expecting that the counsel, as promised at the deposition, would get in contact with his client and forward the information to the client to return back to the United States. What is not in the record, but because you're Honor had asked, is that Matt Witt counsel replied that they had lost contact with their client, that the phone number had disconnected and there was no other way to reach them.
But that's nowhere, okay, that is nowhere in the record, and neither judge was informed of that information.
And Your
Honor,
is that
correct?
That is correct. And it's nowhere in the record because, again, defense counsel did not object. It was widely
Isn't
accepted.
Isn't it the government's responsibility to prove unavailability even if the defendant doesn't object?
Yes, Your Honor, it is. And in this case, to distinguish our facts from Matasias, we do have a record of attempts, reasonable attempts, to reach the material witness and that everyone accepted that the material witness
but
was unavailable.
But there's nothing on the record about an attempt to procure the witness for the actual trial date. I understand that we have things on the record with respect to the February trial date, but that's not when the trial took place. So, I mean, that's what I'm struggling with. You can tell us that, you know, there's some background information that we don't see on the record, but that, I mean, obviously we can't consider that.
Yes, Your Honor, and even under that, even with the record that we do have, it's distinguished from Matasias. We do have some record of attempts to reach the material witness, but at the end of the day, Matasias still affirmed because under the, whether it's the harmlessness or the, under the plain error prong of affecting the fairness and integrity of trial, there was also nothing in the record that would suggest the material witness had anything different to say, that the material witness was available, that had the material witness shown up, they would have testified differently from trial. And that's why under plain error, the government still prevails here, because defense counsel had an opportunity to object. We had an opportunity to develop the record and avoid error, but because defense counsel did not, and we still have some record
right,
of reasonable efforts.
Right, but as Judge Desai just noted, that you're misplacing the burden in this case. You're misplacing the burden here. I don't see any evidence that the government put in before the district court about Rosales-Flores' unavailability for the actual trial date, and I don't see any findings by the district court as to unavailability. I don't see how that's not plain error under Matisyas. And Matisyas, we affirmed, but there Matisyas hadn't alleged that the witness was available. And here you have Murad really vigorously disputing Rosales-Flores' unavailability for trial.
Your Honor, again, based on the record that we do have, there was no indication that the material witness, Rosales-Flores, was available. But
that's not the standard. I mean, the standard has to be that there is indication that the material witness was available because of the statements that were made at the deposition, that he promised to appear, that he had an actual attorney that was in contact with him. There's nothing in the record that says that the attorney lost contact with him. The record before us shows that the material witness had an attorney that had been in contact with him. There were parole documents in place to allow him to come back. There is nothing to indicate that he would not come back. He promised he would come back at the deposition. So I don't see where there's anything in the record where he was unavailable, which is different from Matisyas.
Well, Your Honor, perhaps because he had parole letters for prior trial dates that he was able to come back and he still didn't, the lack of his absence on those prior dates can be inferred that he's unavailable has lost contact with
him. Or you can infer that his lawyer told him the trial was continued, or you don't need to come for this trial. They're going to set it up for another trial date. I mean, that's why he has a lawyer, to tell him when the trial date is. And there's nothing that shows at that point. I think the government has to make the finding. It's on the government to say he's unavailable, because you have to assume he is available.
And, Your Honor, based on the government's contacts with the material witness at counsel, material witness is represented, his counsel is noticed on ECF, the counsel did not provide the government any affirmative understanding that his client would return for a new trial date.
And that should have been placed, though, on the record before, on the date of the trial or close to the date of the trial, at a motion in limine, the day of the trial or the day, days before. I don't think that was done, was it?
It wasn't done, Your Honor, but again, it was because defense counsel had no problem. It was widely accepted that the material witness was not coming back for this trial. And so turning back to the mechanic's letter, Your Honors, this letter was clearly unreliable, and Judge Robinson reviewed it with the appropriate level of skepticism. As Your Honor noted, the author got his own name wrong. It was undated. It was supposedly verified by two witnesses, but again, those witnesses in turn themselves were not verified. They didn't provide declarations, they didn't provide IDs, contact information. The police officer didn't even identify the municipality or precinct that he was stationed for. As the district court appropriately found, the signatures of these purported witnesses don't establish in any meaningful way that the letter was particularly reliable. Beyond that, the only corroboration of the letter's details is Ms. Murad's own self-serving statements. And other than the reference to a killer opener, which it doesn't appear that anyone knows what that means, it doesn't raise any new details that were not previously known to investigators or produced in discovery. Lastly, to address briefly defense or counsel's argument in the letter that the letter was translated from Spanish to English. That raises yet another layer of unreliability. There's no indication who the translator was, if they were certified, if they were qualified, if the mechanic was given a chance to review the accuracy of the translation or even understood what he was signing when he signed an English letter. Turning to the other two points under 804b3, the mechanic was unavailable by design. Defense counsel had never subpoenaed him, didn't ask the government to provide him a parole letter, so he had no opportunity to show up in court even if he wanted to. And I think that's where the cart is being put before the horse. Counsel argues that even if he had shown up, he would have invoked, but it ignores the initial step of inviting him, giving him an opportunity to show up. And under the court's decision in Fowley, the unavailability of that witness cuts directly against the likelihood that he would be exposed to criminal liability. In Fowley, the court found that where a declarant is outside the reach of the United States, it's unreasonable to believe that they would be subjected to criminal liability, regardless of whether their statement had a tendency to expose them to that. And so we believe that the court did not abuse its discretion in excluding let error, that it did not plainly error in admitting the Matwood deposition, and we would ask this court to affirm.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll give you 1 minute for rebuttal. Go ahead.
I just want to make it clear.
I know you only have a minute, so I'm sorry to jump in right at the outset, but can you address the second two? Let's assume that we agree with you that there was error and the error was plain with respect to the video deposition. Can you address the second two prongs or the last two prongs of the plain error analysis?
Yeah, and I just want to – this might take me
you
over
can,
a little
and you
bit.
You can answer the question. Go ahead.
What we just heard about falling out of contact –
yeah, I don't really – we're not considering that. That's information okay. That's not in the record. It's not – I really want to understand from you how you think you can satisfy the last two prongs of the plain error analysis, which is whether or not the error affected your client's substantial rights and whether the error seriously affected the fairness
right.
and integrity
and I think
of the proceeding.
The answer to that question, Your Honor, begins at government brief page 45, where the government just says in briefing exactly the opposite of what you just heard. Here there is no evidence – This is a quote from the government. Here, there is no evidence that Rosales's attorney fell out of touch with his client or that the United States held back contact information. So there is no evidence. So that means that, to the contrary, we credit the promise to show up. So if the government had given the correct subpoena with the correct trial date, he would have been able to show up. That's the operating assumption. Because they didn't give the correct subpoena, so we're now sitting in Judge Robinson's court. They try to put in the deposition testimony. If the defense objects, Judge Robinson is supposed to say, okay, what good faith efforts did you make to get him here today? And they don't have it because they didn't give him a subpoena for the correct trial date.
Still haven't answered my question, which is how is this a violation of the substantial rights of your client,
okay.
and how does it affect the integrity and fairness of the proceeding
Perfect.
That there wasn't a finding of unavailability and that the video deposition was allowed?
Because he couldn't have testified. The deposition testimony couldn't have come in. If it couldn't have come in, there was no evidence as to alienage or financial gain. Those are essential elements of both crimes. Therefore, he couldn't have been convicted. The evidence would have been insufficient as a matter of law. That affects the substantial rights because there could have been no conviction, and obviously a conviction that with a mandatory minimum of 3 years that results, it affects the fairness and integrity of judicial proceedings.
Any other questions? All right. Thank you very much. We thank both counsel for their
thank
arguments
you so much.
This morning, and this case is submitted.